Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, I bow my head, dear Lord. I want to remember on a daily basis, even every minute and every second, that I can do all things, all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. Father God, speak to me and bless your people. Let your spirit rest and abide here in this place as we celebrate the accomplishments of our ancestors. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
It's good to be here, and I can keep saying it over and over again, but you know we're here celebrating Black History Month because of Dr. Carter G. Woodson. Carter G. Woodson is known as the father of Black History. He started Black History Week in 1926. And not until 50 years later, because in 1976, we started celebrating, as your pastor mentioned earlier, the entire month of February. But Carter Goodson had a vision, and he knew that there were people who had made strides and helped build this country, and he knew that we must take the time to recognize them. Now, if I can back up a minute, we used to celebrate just one week in February. He chose the second week in February because he was remembering the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass. Now, you may have heard Abraham Lincoln is the person who freed the slaves, but I beg to differ. That's a totally different history lesson that I could share with you.
Right.
But because of political reasons, he was able to get the credit because of the Emancipation Proclamation. But really, Frederick Douglass was the abolitionist who made a difference and decided that, yes, we need to do some things different. So I think Carter G. Woodson basically said, well, the second week is the best week because of those two individuals. Now, so often during Black History Month, I'm sure you all have heard of Dr. Martin Luther King. You've heard about Harriet Tubman and maybe some modern day leaders. But today, I would like to share some stories, and I hope you can follow me because I have a reason for how I'm going to present this to you. I'm going to talk about Booker T. Washington, and I'm also going to talk about W.E.B. Du Bois, and then I'm going to share with you another name you may not be familiar with. His name is Dr. Jawanza Kanjufi. Now, Booker T. Washington, you know him for being the president, and back in that day, the principal of Tuskegee Institute. Now, Dr. Washington believed that the right education that our people could meet would be the challenges of the past. He felt that we needed to have a vision. And that vision was not so much of working any job, but he felt that as a race of people, we needed to have some type of industrial training. Industrial training, he felt that we would be respected more by the other race. And that was true for that time, because I'm not going to focus just on men. You may say, well, you're the lady here, but I have to tell you that there's God Almighty, and he put man on earth, and there's a mission and charge he has given to the men in our lives. Women, we have to let them be men. We have to acknowledge them. As long as they're following God and his rule, you don't have to worry about it, because you're not going to be led down a different road. But back to Dr. Washington. In 1895, he gave a speech to an audience of white males who were attending a conference of Atlanta Cotton State and International Exposition. Now, Washington stressed that for social justice to become a reality, each part of the population should reach out and work together. You know, there's strength in numbers. And he was believing that we needed to work together. It did not matter whether you were white, whether you were black. We could make a difference if we come together. And he felt that men should have a train. Well, what would this world be? This edifice had to be built by someone who knew something about laying bricks. You know, somebody had to be here who could fix the electrical wiring and do all those things. So he was thinking about trades in that area. And I'll tell you how he disagreed with Brother Dubois later on. But anyway, Washington felt that if we could work together, we could change our conditions. And not so much our conditions, we're talking about our forebears during that particular time. For some reason, our young people, and I've heard it so often with young males, oh, they won't let me do nothing. It's his fault, I can't do nothing, you know. And not to be disrespectful, say, oh, the white man is holding me back. That's sad.
It is.
It's sad because we wouldn't be discussing Booker T. Washington or W.E.B. Du Bois or any of the people, our president or any person who is a black person who has succeeded, because those ones who succeeded are here because they wanted to make a difference.
Right.
They wanted to do something for others. Yes. Now I'm sold on it's all about other people. And that's how our people have made it over the years. We have to reach up, reach not to down to them, but pull them up. And this is what Washington was saying, and I want you young people to remember that you can do and be anything you want to be. It's a mindset.
It's a mindset.
Work doesn't kill you. Hard work builds character. There are no free rides in America. Somebody's paying. Somebody's paying. And I want to tell you a little story here that Washington told to this group, this audience that he was talking to. He said that there was a lost ship at sea. And for many days, this vessel had just been going further and farther out into sea. And one day, this ship, another ship was sighted. And as the other ship was sighted, the captain of the distressed vessel kept saying, "Water, water." And the person in this other boat who just come up says, "Cast down your bucket where you are." Well, two or three other distress calls came again. The second one, "Water, water, send us water." Again, the response was, "Cast down your bucket where you are." Finally, the captain, who had been on this distressed ship, he heeded the call, and he cast his bucket into the water, and the bucket was filled with fresh, sparkling water from the mouth of the Amazon River. Well, Mr. Washington's words ring true today. If we as a race of people are going to better our conditions, we too must cast down our buckets where we are. So often, many young people like to have the nice things in life, and they want to start at the top. But you know, there's a process. I tell my students, you don't plant corn today and eat corn on the cob tomorrow. So you have to start where you are to move forward. And so often, we want things now, but there is a process. I call it delayed gratification. Also, Washington was known as a well-known educator, and like I said, he started Tuskegee Institute, and he actually was the president of Tuskegee until his death, and he died at the age of 61. And believe it or not, a church was very instrumental in providing a place for this institution or school to start. It was by the Butler AME Zion Church. They provided a spot, a little shanty during that time, for this great institution it once stood on a plot of land provided by this particular church. And I'm here to tell you that churches are involved, and I hear the things that you all are doing here at this place, that you're making a difference. And that's what it's all about. Also, Washington believed that the trade again, was the economic security that we needed. But W.E.B. Du Bois felt a little differently. He believed that education was more important than a trade. He felt that people should study the arts, you know, the doctors, the lawyers, the dentists, and all those. But you know, I have to agree with both men, because in order to build a building, you need carpenter, you need roofers, you need electrician, you need plumber, and you've got to have an education to be able to have a blueprint. So somebody's got to be able to learn how to read a blueprint. So the two go hand in hand. And these two men differed in their beliefs, but their main concern was that men would prepare themselves for a brighter future. W.E.B. Du Bois did not know his father, but he was raised by a nurturing mother. He did well in school, and he won a scholarship to attend Fisk University in Nashville, which is a historically black college, and he graduated from Fisk with two bachelor's degrees and a master's degree, and then he continued his studies at Harvard University, and he was the first African American to actually achieve the level of having a doctorate degree from Harvard. Humble beginnings. Each of you can do that, young guys. You all can start right here on Game Street. We can read about you in years to come if you take Jesus with you. If you realize where your help comes from. Because I'm sure W.E.B. Du Bois, and I'm sure Booker T. Washington knew the Lord. And our people have always fallen back on the church. And I think we have lost our way in this modern world, and we need to come back to where our start, our very beginnings. Also, W.E.B. Du Bois is the author of a book called The Souls of Black Folk. Any of you ever heard the book? I would encourage you to read that book, because I think the book, what he was talking about when he wrote the book in 1800s, he actually was talking about things that are actually happening here in 2012. It's amazing the mindset, the visionaries that these men were doing previous years. Actually, Du Bois published several books, but he was active in helping create organizations to empower African Americans, not just males, but the African American. He also used the term the talented 10. And at some point, I'd like for you to take the time to read about the talented 10, because he was talking about educating men to write books, become leaders of the world, as well as promoting social change. Social change. He also said that he believed that blacks needed a classical education to be able to reach their potential rather than the industrial education provided by Booker T. Washington. As I said, the two men disagreed, but they both had a vision for a better day. He saw education as a basis of what in the 20th century we known as public intellectuals. That's what Du Bois was saying about public intellectuals. He also felt like the teachers, the priests, the scientists, the doctors, the lawyers, politicians, bankers, that those were the areas that these men needed to go into. But as I said earlier, you can't have one without the other. I'm here to tell you this morning that education and work are the lifters, are the levers that uplift our people. Education is so important. Work alone will not do it unless you're inspired by the right ideas and guided by intelligence. Somebody has to know something. Education does not simply teach work, it must teach life. We're talking about lifelong learning skills. The talented 10th of the Negro race must be made leaders of thought and missionaries of culture among their people. No other can do this work, and Negro colleges must train men for it. The Negro race, like other races, is going to be saved by exceptional men.